Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today, let's see the current affairs of 18 September 2018. The news articles we'll be seeing today are these seven. Let's see them all in detail now. The first article we'll be seeing is with respect to topic environment, saving rivers. Yesterday's paper had a report of published by Central Pollution Control Board on the level of pollution in Indian rivers, and this editorial, it analyzes the facts given in the yesterday's article. So according to the report published by Central Pollution Control Board, it has stated that the number of polluted rivers in our country has risen from 351 to from 302 in past couple of years. And this is in spite of many laws and policies implemented in order to protect the rivers and also to regulate the waste management in our country with respect to different states. The policy also highlighted the failures of various national programs of the center as well as the states in the spheres of river conservation, preservation of wetland and water quality monitoring with respect to all the rivers in our country. And one of the critical facts mentioned in this report is with respect to the river Ganga. So it has been found empirically that the water in river Ganga is much cleaner than several other rivers in our country. This may be attributed to the excessive central funding dedicated only to clean river Ganga due to the cultural importance attached to the river. Stating facts, it has been known that about 3,000 crores has been spent to clean river Ganga alone in past 3 years, whereas only 351 crores has been sent for rest all the rivers in our country covering 14 states for their protection. The report also added that the states of Maharashtra, Gujarat and Assam fare very bad in river waste management in our country. This problem of river water pollution, especially in these states, is worsened by additional poor infrastructure available in very large cities and towns which are located very close to the rivers. And it is also to be noted that the Central Pollution Control Board, it conducted this survey only after constant efforts put in by the National Green Tribunal to evaluate the position of rivers in our country. Ideally, this survey, which is to be conducted once in few years, is not conducted by CPCB, which adds to the problem of empirically analyzing the pollution level in different rivers in the country. As we all know that India is facing rapid urbanization in past few years, and this urbanization is not going in same phase as with planned infrastructure development. This gap leads to river pollution in many states. And apart from managing the infrastructure, having dedicated waste management facilities and also power supply is very much essential to maintain cleanliness of rivers. Low priority accorded to the enforcement of laws which are already existing by State Pollution Control Board as well as the Central Pollution Control Board is also one of the reasons which can be attributed to this poor state of Indian river system. In order to enhance the health of Indian river system, the role which is to be played by Indian civil societies is very much essential. Only a sustained effort by the civil society group can put in pressure on the government and bring in a time-bound change with respect to the health of the rivers. From the industrial side, the various industrial owners must use various technologies available in order to protect the rivers and dispose the waste very efficiently. Unless the above said measures are not done, India's rivers will continue to die and it will also pose a serious threat to public health due to the contamination of the water and consumption of water by the general public. According to 2013 World Bank's report, the environmental degradation is costing India at least $80 billion a year, most of a part of which also is attributed to river pollution. So only if this river pollution is stopped, India's public health will improve and so does India's economy. The second article we'll be seeing today is with respect to India and Nepal relations, Himalayan divide on drift in India-Nepal ties. So the past few months has seen upheaval in relationship between India and Nepal on several fronts. So despite several attempts done by both Indian and Nepali side, the situation is still a cause of concern. So recently, last week, BIMSTEC, which is Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multisectoral and Economic Cooperation, it conducted its military exercises in India. So in this BIMSTEC military exercise, the disconnect between the Nepali and the Indian side was constantly most visibly evident. And this is a serious cause of concern. Nepal, despite having confirmed their participation in the month of June, they had to pull out in the last instance, stating political decisions. According to Prime Minister Mr. Oli of Nepal, the decision to conduct the BIMSTEC military exercise in India was unilaterally announced by the Prime Minister of India without considering the views of the BIMSTEC host country, which is Nepal, during the BIMSTEC summit. This was not just a problem for the country of Nepal, but also Thailand showed serious reservations in this issue. With this drift between India and Nepal, the China factor also comes in and plays a very important role. So Nepal's decision to join 12-day Mount Everest friendship exercise with China in Sichuan province and also to be part of anti-terrorism drills with China seriously is an area of concern between India and Nepal. With this drift, Nepal's closeness with China is also an area of concern for India. The Nepal's decision to join China in a 12-day Mount Everest friendship exercise in Sichuan province, and also which was focused on anti-terrorism drills, adds to the tension existing between India and Nepal relationship. Apart from just sharing an open border, India and Nepal, they also share traditional links between the militaries of both the sides. And this traditional links should not be undermined just due to lack of communication between both the sides. It is also to be mentioned that the year 2015, it saw a very low point between India and Nepal relationship. The economic blockade in Nepal, which has destabilized the Nepalese economy, is due to India, according to the Nepali political forces. This with increasing Chinese development, especially in the sectors of hydropower, infrastructure and transport in Nepal, New Delhi just can't turn a blind eye without addressing the issue with its neighboring state of Nepal. So it is very high time that India and Nepal makes use of modern technology and other connectivity projects in order to utilize the geographical role to benefit both the countries. Modern technology and connectivity projects, it can seriously take away the geography's role as a guarantee of good relations, especially with the domain of China now. So it is high time that India acts proactively and ensure that this good relation is restored between India and Nepal. The third article we'll be seeing today is with respect to Uniform Civil Code, the progressive way. So as we all know, a month ago, a consultation paper was released by the Law Commission of India, which spoke about Uniform Civil Code. So it attributed that the Uniform Civil Code is neither feasible nor necessary at this stage in our country. So this view of Law Commission was perceived to be against one nation, one law by several people in our country. We all know that India is a highly plural country and a diverse country. So history has many instances of this pluralistic legal system where multiple sources of law, they mutually coexisted with each other. So it can be stated that the Law Commission, it has rightly recognized this pluralism existing in our country with respect to different religions, languages, etc. Constitutional provisions of equality and non-discrimination, which is also part of fundamental rights ensured to all the citizens of our country. So let's also see some of the Supreme Court and High Court judgments attached to this issue. So number one, the Supreme Court has proactively been advocating for bringing in UCC in our country. Okay, and according to this author, the Supreme Court has been a supporter of UCC without fully appreciating or understanding the ground realities existing in our country. For instance, in the case of Vikramjit Singh in ABC vs. State in 2015, the Supreme Court observed that our directive principle envisioned the existence of Uniform Civil Code, but this remains an unaddressed constitutional expectation. And also in another judgment in 2015 called as Sarla Mudgal, the Supreme Court also reiterated this view. It said that India believes in one nation and therefore no community can claim separate religious laws. Historically, it is also to be mentioned that even the Constituent Assembly had the same question when they were framing the constitution, and finally it was held that this provision is out of the scope of fundamental rights and so it stays non-justiciable. The author also supports the view of Law Commission by quoting multiple examples. For example, it is a myth that all Hindus are governed by a homogeneous law, that is the same law which is enacted via Hindu Code Bill. And this applies even to Muslims and Christians, which means there are multiple laws existing within the religious community. For example, the constitution itself protects the traditional local customs of state of Nagaland. The state of Goa, it has its separate uniform code. And even among Muslims, the Sharia Act 1937 is not extended to state of Goa. And another important point is that, so the author also stresses upon the fact that one talks only about the implementation of uniform civil code, and simply one does not talk about the other directive principles of state policy which are not implemented. For example, providing right to work, providing living wages, distribution of community reserves, avoidance of concentration of wealth, or protecting the environment, they all also form a part of DPSP. However, there is immense concentration given only for the implementation of UGC at the cost of rest of the provisions in directive principles of state policy. So in a democratic country, just laws are far more important than uniform law. So a piecemeal reform should not be carried forward unless it is highly just and highly inclusive. The fourth article we'll be seeing today is with respect to refugee crisis existing in many parts of the world and also in India. No lands people. So a large number of people in the world today are stateless, and they are thus deprived of their basic rights that majority of other citizens of other countries enjoy. So this problem is very significant, especially in the Indian context. So not just because of the Rohingya crisis which is unfolding in India and its neighboring countries, also because of the issue of National Register of Citizens in Assam. It is a worrying fact that about 40 lakh people in Assam have been left out of this National Register of Citizens, and many of them have reportedly not been given the reason for their omission of the name from the list. And even within the family, some people are included in the list and some people are excluded from the list. And what happens to the names of the people who are excluded from the list is highly uncertain. So the author in this article, he brings in an international perspective of the acceptance rate of refugees in different parts of the world. The Myanmar State Councillor Aung San Suu Kyi, she draw a lot of criticism from the international community because of not taking enough steps to protect the Rohingya citizens who are an essential part of Myanmar. So the India, it also turned down the request of Rohingya refugees, saying it is a threat to the internal security of our country. So this pattern, it repeats in many developed countries of the world. For example, US has also condemned this. And same is the situation in case of Germany and even Britain, which considered the refugee question as a big part of the Brexit referendum. So here there's a big question of the consciousness of the community. So even if the political leadership, they come forward to accept the immigrants, the xenophobia of the community, that is the collective consciousness of the whole society, is forcing them not to accept the immigrants, seeing them only as a threat to their security. So this view of increasing ethnocentrism is posing a serious crisis to the refugee situation across the world. So apart from this individual perceptions, there is no international cooperation on this refugee rehabilitation. And the media attention shown to this refugee issue are too one-sided. For example, the continent of Africa, it has disproportionately accommodated almost 80% of the world's refugees in spite of they themselves having a very high population. But this is not focused by the media. Though protecting borders and containing national threats to security is very much essential for any developed or developing country, so is the values of basic humanism and the equality given to different people. So cooperation among different governments and tolerance among its citizens is very much essential in order to find a solution to this conflict situation. The fifth article we'll be seeing today is Missions Will Rule Workplace by 2025. So a recently released report by World Economic Forum titling Future of Job, it has reported that in less than 7 years, that is by 2025, the missions is projected to overtake human beings in 12 key industrial sectors. So this diagram, it shows the significant projected rise of machine forces by 2025. So in the sectors of reasoning and decision making, coordinating, developing, managing and advising jobs, job-related information sector and data processing jobs, they will see a significant rise in the use of machines when compared to human labor. Globally, almost half of all the companies, they are expected to use automation to cut their full-time workforce in the years to come. However, this rise in automation will not lead to unemployment, as new job opportunities will be created. And especially in this sector, India needs to focus on its reskilling in order to achieve the projected economic growth according to WEF report. The sixth article we'll be seeing today is Chinese intrusions declined by 10% this year, says official. We all know that the tension exists between India and China, especially along its eastern borders. So there has been 10% decline in the number of Chinese transgression this year, according to the government sources. And it is also added that the presence of Chinese troops along the line of actual control, it also dropped by 30%, as manpower has been substituted by powerful surveillance equipment using technology by China. So there has been thaw in China and India relationship after the Doklam standoff. So there has been increased effort both diplomatically between the Chinese and Indian counterparts, so that there is no steep increase in tensions between India and China. Both the sides have also been conducting long patrols in order to avoid territorial claims, and these patrols are especially undertaken in the locations of Ladakh and Arunachal Pradesh recently. The last article we'll be seeing today is Niti Aayog for clear policy for jhoom cultivation. So the Niti Aayog has published a report recently titled Mission on Shifting Cultivation Towards Transformational Approach. So this mission, it concentrates on developing an inter-ministerial convergence. So currently, this jhoom cultivation has been managed both by Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Northeastern States, as well as Ministry of Environment. Currently, this jhoom cultivation policy has been maintained by Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Environment, as well as the Ministry of respective Northeastern States. So this has led to a state of confusion, which has taken a toll on environment, especially in the Northeastern States. This jhoom cultivation is especially practiced in the states of Arunachal Pradesh, Nagaland, Mizoram, Meghalaya, Tripura and Manipur even today. The wasteland atlas map, which has been released recently for the northeastern states, it shows a reduction in the practice of jhoom cultivation from 16,000 square kilometer to 8,000 odd square kilometer in past 2 years, and this is a very welcoming trend. A very important reason for this reduction is the positive impact of MNREGA scheme, which has given employment to many people in the northeastern region. The publication, apart from developing a unified policy, it also ensures that the food and nutritional security of the communities in northeastern region are ensured while they make a transition from jhoom cultivation to other methods of cultivation for the farmers employed in agriculture in the states. Thank you.